west in Worthington, Minnesota. I mean, where you can see 70 miles and there isn't a bump. So from me to be able to go one of the highest places in the world and travel, if I can do it, I tell every physician, you can do it. And if you want this kind of experience or challenge yourself in this way, this is very accessible to you. There's a huge demand as I travel the world for physicians from the U.S. to be involved in many of these kind of experiences. Well, I think if you're going to be involved in something like Everest ER, or you guys watched the movie last night on Doctors Without Borders, and it's an amazing group that I've kind of interacted with over the years, you kind of have to either hate or love the travel world. It's you spend way too much time. I'm currently wanting to go to sleep desperately right now because I'm 6 days from returning from 30 days in Tibet, which is exactly 12 hours opposite from here. So this is my nighttime. I'll be up all night, and I definitely want, so if I nod off, someone yell at me. But I think that travel experience is always kind of interesting and amazing. This is a NASA satellite of the world at nighttime. I tell people I like to go to those dark places where there are no lights. Let's see if there's a, oh good, this works, good. So the fact is we're going to kind of take a little journey and go to the other side of the world. Typically when I fly to Nepal, and I thought what I would do this afternoon is just kind of walk you up the trail with me, and then we're going to get to Everest ER and show you some cases and some fun things up there. Typically I leave out of LAX and fly the 18-hour flight to Bangkok, thank God for Thai Airlines, and from Bangkok you can go through Seoul, but again, if you haven't been to Nepal or don't know where that is, it's kind of a little country squished between China and India. It's an amazing little place. It takes about 24 hours to get there, but about 3 days. So if you leave on a Friday from Salt Lake City, you'll be in Kathmandu on Sunday morning. That's kind of typical. It's a country that, have a lot of people been to Nepal? Anybody in here been to Nepal? I'm sure a lot of people have, a few people. Okay. So I'm going to kind of just kind of give you a little orientation to this amazing little place. It's a very small country, three sides surrounded by India. And one side borders basically the Tibetan Plateau in Tibet and China. I just came from the Tibetan side, which was kind of an amazing new experience for me dealing with the regulations in China. But this country is only about 150 kilometers or so in width. Okay, so you're going to be at all the way the highest point in the world, and within about 100 kilometers, you know, you can be, this is me last week getting on my elephant in the Terai region. And again, you can be down in the jungle. We're actually bathing elephants during this afternoon, which was a lot of fun. And again, you could be kind of mingling with the rhinoceroses that hang around the southern part of Nepal. So in a very short period of time, you can be from some of the most remote, cold, roughest climates in the world, all the way down to now I have to worry about malaria and dengue fever and leptospirosis. So it's an amazing process. When one flies into Kathmandu, you realize you're not in Kansas anymore. It's kind of like, really? Oh, so this is Kathmandu. It is truly an amazing corner of the world. This is my wife in 1998. At that time, she's still wearing skirts. That was kind of necessary, really, for a lot of the respect that you had when you travel Nepal. That's kind of lightened up a lot. But, you know, you go through this this airport and then kind of walk into the city of Kathmandu. This is where we start everything. The Tamil region, which is most people familiar with in the tourist areas, right over here. It sits in this beautiful valley, but it's a very, very eclectic series. I hate that when that happens. It's a real crazy place to hang out. A lot of people don't like Kathmandu. I have this sixth sense of enjoyment in Kathmandu because there's just so many crazy things that go on in this community. When you first get there, you know, you're kind of overwhelmed. There's a book that I ask people to always read called Culture Shock if you ever go to Nepal, because that's really what most of us will have. If you've never experienced kind of the mass third world world, it's just kind of totally insane and really does make people kind of nuts. The thing I love about it is it's probably one of the most colorful cities, as many of the third world countries are, whether you're in India or in Nepal, the colors and the contrasts are just ongoingly amazing to me. You'll walk across some building that I look at it and it's just like, I mean, that's really quite beautiful in some respects. Love the dog. And then you turn around and then you find someone selling these. And this is just, again, the color that you sometimes find around the city is just very, very spectacular. And it's truly a city and a country of major contrasts. Incredible, credible poverty. It's in the bottom 10 of revenue and income-producing GDP countries in the world. Most of them are in Africa, the first top 8, but Nepal sits in the top 10. About the average annual income will sit somewhere about $400 US a year. So my camera will be a lot more than the vast majority of the folks that I interact with. You also have to recognize that when you get to Kathmandu, that, you know, there is no separation, and I tell physicians this, really between church and state, like we have here. It's very Hindu, it's very Buddhist, and in many respects you'll find this influence throughout the entire community. This is Bodhinath. This is one of the very sacred stupas that's a Buddhist temple right across the street, essentially, from the Hyatt, where you can be sitting in the swimming pool. You sit and have the butter tea lamps, and you can find certainly the prayer wheels. Everywhere you go, you'll see people spinning prayer wheels, and that has kind of the Om Mani Padme Om, which is the mantra, one of the mantras of the Buddhist, a jewel of the lotus flower. So again, you're immersed in this really different culture and experience. As a physician, and what we're doing is we're getting our medical supplies and everything ready to go in Kathmandu, and you kind of visit many of these stupas and Buddhist temples, and it's really quite a beautiful place. Again, prayer flags are the same thing. You'll find their mantras kind of all over these flags, and as they believe, as they kind of whip in the wind, that they let these beautiful mantras go, and it brings them good karma and good luck. And it has to do, the colors have to do with earth, wind, water, and those things. So it's a very amazing thing. On the other hand, you kind of run into the Hindu side of it. When you're down the lowlands, most of the Buddhists live up in the mountain region, and the Hindus are really kind of more in the lowlands. So you'll just see these pictures of the Hindi holy men, the lotus flower, which you'll see everywhere. And typically these guys are walking the streets all over the place. By the way, they're not hesitant to charge you for a picture. They're very capitalist, I noticed. So it's a great place to kind of hang out and regroup. This is one of the Hindu temples. This is one of the most amazing sights and experiences you have. You're sitting actually in a bridge. I'm actually in a bridge right now. And there's this beautiful, very old Hindi temple, Pushampanti, that I'm at, and I look to my right, and I'm seeing these beautiful, you know, these are people bathing and washing in, the Bagmati River, which is a branch of the Ganges, so it's very, very, very sacred to them, and you can see them kind of doing, and it's just so colorful. I mean, like, you don't see that in the States, really so much, the beautiful colors and sarongs and everything that they wear. And then I actually go and I turn to my left, And this is, by the way, how they dye their stuff. You find these dyes all over the place. But you turn to the left, and this is what you see. And they have cremations there on a regular basis, and it's kind of unnerving that you think you're visiting someone's funeral while you're sitting at this really sacred Hindi temple. And this happens all day long, and it's just kind of normal for them. It's really unnerving for those of us that kind of visit there, kind of going, well, this is a very strange place, but it's what they do. Well, we're not here to talk about Kathmandu and all the crazy things we're in to get to the mountains. To go from Kathmandu, you take a flight and you go to a little airport called Lukla, which sits around 8,000 feet. And those of you that watch the History Channel and kind of the most dangerous airports in the world, this is number one. Lukla was listed as the most dangerous airport in the world. And I have a video at the end I'll show you that kind of tells you why. But the fact is that we fly into Lukla from Kathmandu. It's about a 30-minute flight. And when you first take off from Kathmandu, many times you've never seen the Himalayas. You're in this valley. It's kind of cloud-covered. It's high humidity. It's usually warm. It was about 90s in Kathmandu when I just left it a few days ago. But you kind of take off. Thank God they use twin otters, because if I ever needed to fly, I think I could fly this thing. And you kind of take off and, you know, kind of get above the clouds. And you know you're trying to head to the Himalayas finally. And ultimately, remember, there are no FAA regulations. That's what I love about this place. I can sit with a beer and a cocktail in my hand, and actually I'm looking out. I'm sitting right between the pilots right now. And there's the runway. And I kind of wanted to be the pilots, because as you can see, there's a mountain right here. So it's one way in, one way out. And you just hope they got a steady hand and the weather's good. But the fact is things have improved a lot. This is Lukla. This was in 1998 when I first went, and I worked at Faraday at the clinic at around 14,000 feet. By the way, I should mention that when the reason a lot of us kind of go over there is there's an organization called the Himalayan Rescue Association. It's been there since 1973. What they noticed is that there's been so many trekkers and folks that have died due to altitude illness and all sorts of stuff back in 1973. They actually created this organization, and they actually have a clinic in the Annapurna region, kind of in the central Nepal region, and then they have a clinic at the 14,000-foot level on the trek up to Everest Base Camp. And these have been kind of long-standing clinics. Now, to work there, typically it's a four-month stint. Usually when my wife and I go, we leave kind of the first part of September, and we try to always make it back by Christmas time. So it's quite a commitment when you go, of course, it's all volunteer. And then the Everest ER, we actually started in 2003 on the 50th anniversary of Hillary and Tenzing summiting Everest, and that's part of the Himalayan Rescue Association I'll talk more about. But you'll see it was all grass strip, and now it's, geez, nice new concrete. The thing that really hasn't changed is the bathrooms. And you can always tell that someone truly has had altitude illness because they can't ever seem to hit it. But if that's the same, it hasn't changed. When you actually go on a trek, and many of us really have never trekked. We backpack, we do stuff. Trekking is a whole different game. It's very relaxing. It's really supposed to be enjoying the culture and enjoying the people. You don't have to hump a pack on your back. Matter of fact, I encourage people, as much as I think people like, I see all these Europeans and stuff humping these huge packs as they go on up. The economy in the Khumbu area is based on the porters and Sherpas doing what they do. That really is how they make their living. And by someone carrying a pack and not paying the $3 a day it takes for a porter, you're taking food out of someone's mouth. That's how I look at it. So, you know, you're going to have someone basically carry your stuff, or it's going to go up on yaks. And then basically we kind of go from Lukla, and we're going to walk up this valley to the center of the Khumbu Valley. This is the Khumbu Valley. Everest Base Camp sits up here. Everest is right up here. You can see Mount Everest right there. Thank God for Google Earth. And you get a sense of kind of the valley we're going to walk up. Obviously, one must always prepare, take wine and have a sandwich. But the fact is that, you know, you always have to kind of think about you're going to be gone now, especially for me going up to Everest ER. We typically leave the end of March, and we won't be back till the 1st of June. So we're going to be spending essentially 2 months up there. And in general, you have weight restrictions still on the airlines. So you're going to be limited to 50 pounds per bag and two bags. So it's always an interesting challenge. The trek is beautiful. It's a very easy trek. By the way, from Lukla up to the Everest Base Camp is a total of 30 miles. You could bike that in a day. You could bike it, you could run it in a day, you can walk it in a day. But the fact is, it's going to take us 10 to 12 days, because we're going to go from 8,000 feet up to about 18,000 feet. So we have some acclimatization time and some time we got to get our bodies used to this elevation. So the fact is, this is a beautiful trail that one walks up. You get to see the prayer water wheels that are run by the rivers all over the place. It's a very, very, it's a very wonderful walk. You have a few bridges to cross. These are really fancy and nice. When my wife first went in 1998, these were wooden and had no siding, was a little bit of a challenge. Ativan is a really wonderful drug. But you'll also notice that the porters. This is not part of our group, but these guys that carry these loads are unbelievable. I've watched them carry, literally, and I don't agree with this, they're supposed to be limited to 30-kilo loads, 60-plus pounds. But clearly coming off Everest, I've easily seen 100-kilo loads come down on these guys who don't weigh 100 kilos. And what you'll notice they all do, of course, is use the strap around the head. Now, I tried this one time and then really had to visit my friendly neurosurgeon. It's unbelievable what these efforts do. But that's a huge load. And remember that everything that comes up the valley comes up on a back. Now, they actually used to helicopter things in. And interesting enough, it was the local people and these porters that actually went to the government and said, "You're killing us. You can't do this." And so they basically forbidden helicopters, except for big, big, large expeditions, to bring anything in. So everything is carried on a back. There is no vehicles. There is nothing up there, nothing motorized. It's very quiet, but everything is carried on up. So this is just a video I shot of the amazing Nepali porters. This is carrying up hay for their yaks and animals. And you'll see this up and down the trail the whole time as you trek up to Everest Base Camp. And you'll see these guys cross these bridges. There went an oxygen bottle. Huge loads. And your food comes up this way as well. Everything comes up essentially this way. So this is, by the way, your yak steak coming up. And basically, Dalai Lama has forbidden anything to be killed from Namche Bazaar up. So basically all this meat is basically water buffalo from India. So it's probably already 2 weeks old. It's usually infested with flies and delicious, I will tell you. So by the end of the season, you'd eat that raw. I was with a friend. I have to pick on vegetarians just for a second, because I love vegetarians, because it just means more beef for me. But the fact is that a friend of mine, Martha, went up with me in 98, and she was vegetarian. And after 2 months at Farachay, she couldn't eat enough protein. I mean, she'd eat every yak steak she could get her hands on. You get very protein deficient up in that area. Well, the one thing I will tell you is that these people, we've actually started a porter association, because unfortunately I've had some very, very bad circumstances. I will tell you there was a Western group. I would tell you the initials, but you would recognize who they're from. They lead treks up there all the time. About November one time, I got a knock on the door. It was a pretty heavy blizzard going up at Farachay, about 14,000 feet, and a Swede comes by, all face encrusted in snow and ice, and goes, "You know, I think there's a porter or someone by the up on the trail who's dying." So I quickly put on my mountain gear, and up the trail I went, and sure enough, about 16,000 feet, I find a porter who is left by the side of the trail in a horrible blizzard. And what happened is he was unable to carry his load, so the group fired him. He had cerebral edema is what he had, unfortunately. By the way, these porters are lowland porters. They're not Sherpas. Sherpas are the high country folks. These porters, the vast majority, are lowland, so they get altitude sick just like everybody else. And this poor kid had got cerebral edema, left on the side of the trail because he couldn't carry his load. They hired someone else, and by the time I got to him, he had completely frostbit his feet and required ultimately a bilateral amputation. Now, if you do that in Nepal, it's a death wish, you know, because you're going to be dragging around in Kathmandu begging, because they have no infrastructure to take care of things like that. So we tell everybody who treks over there, including myself, when we hire porters and stuff to carry a load, they're part of my team. They get full health care, they get equipment, we give them everything that we get, and they basically are part of our team. So we ask you to take care of your porters. So you're actually coming on up. This is coming up to Namche now. You're crossing the last bridge as you're headed to Namche. And Namche Bazaar is kind of the central town, if you want to think about it, for the Khumbu Valley. It's kind of where kind of all the commerce and business. And most importantly, every week they hold a market. So there are no grocery stores here. So once a week on a Friday and Saturday, they hold a market in Namche, and that's the only place you can get your food and fresh fruits and vegetables. So we'll have to walk sometimes 6 to 8 hours down, spend the night, shop, and then hike a day or two back. So you have to kind of think about it when you're living there for a period of time. Namche is a beautiful city. It sits kind of on this cirque of a plateau. You'll see right here, actually, they're actually holding market. You can see everybody up in here, but it's these kind of, these are tea houses and regular houses. Everything is very nicely laid out, and you're right now about 11,500 feet. So normally we spend a couple days there just acclimatizing. Now we're at 11,500, hanging out. Namche is a great place. It now has electricity from a hydroelectric plant that was put in. So they have a bar, they have a pool hall, they have the internet, they have a bank. It's kind of a hopping little place right now that is kind of fun to cruise around. But you know, go to market, and market is just kind of this interesting experience where you kind of shop for anything you can think of that can be carried on someone's back. Oh, by the way, they don't spell so well. They will sell everything they can, but it is an amazing experience. And the people, what you'll find is like many places. I mean, this is a very, very impoverished country, and I swear to God, the people are happier than most of the people I ever meet in the United States. They are just happy people. They laugh a lot. They are family oriented. They love to tell jokes. They love to play practical jokes. I'll tell you a story here in a little bit about my wife and a practical joke. So from Namche Bazaar, this is the painful part of the trek. We actually walked up this huge side of the mountain from about 8 to 11,500. Now we actually go all the way back down to the river, and then we climb back up to Tengboche, and then we're going to follow the Dikose River up to Ferche, where the clinic is, and then head up to Everseer. The Kunde Hospital is the Sir Edmund Hillary Hospital that's up there. It's an amazing place. Dr. Kami and his son are Canadian trained. They're Sherpas who are Canadian trained and practice up there. And again, you kind of run into some of the harsh realities. Last time I was up there, I was asked by Dr. Kami to do a consult on a young child who was having extreme respiratory distress, almost kind of a bronchial asthma picture. Kind of after my evaluation, we have lousy x-ray, and seeing this little tiger, I really thought he had significant pulmonary hypertension. And quite honestly, had this kid come down, I'm about 12,400 feet right now, if I could get this kid down to Kathmandu or sea level, he'd do a million, he'd be like $1 million. But the fact is that, so I tried to get mom to bring this kid down who was now getting more and more in respiratory distress. And I said, you know, your child may die up here. And she looks at me and goes, buddy Sherpa. And you know, the harsh reality of if they don't survive and can't survive in that Sherpa culture and that altitude, they weren't destined to survive. And this child did die. And it was very sad. I almost wanted to fly this kid out myself and get this kid down because I really thought we could have salvaged this little tiger. When you get to Tengboche, you visit the monastery. This is the famous Tengboche Monastery that actually burned to the ground. And again, Sir Edmund Hillary rebuilt. He was an amazing man. I got to see him once in his last visit to Nepal when he had pulmonary hypertension, by the way. He had very bad pulmonary hypertension, Sir Edmund did. Couldn't go back up to altitude. He actually flew into Namche on oxygen and a helicopter, and we had kind of stood by medically for him. But he actually rebuilt this monastery for the folks. And again, one of the things I love to go for is the kids. I mean, kids in these places that I visit are just amazing, amazing kids, bright, intelligent. I had one kid in Bengkar, kind of by Namche, who's kind of semi-adopted right now, who wants to be one of the first Sherpa pilots, and he heard I was a pilot. So I'm literally all night in a tea house. He's drawing wings, and how does the wings stay up, and how does this work, and blah, blah, blah. And great kids, very curious. And by the way, just for educational sake, this is an 8-year-old who goes to the Sir Edmund Hillary School, which is near that monastery. So he goes from about 8,500 feet to 12,500. He walks there alone on the trail on Sunday, spends Sunday through Saturday morning at the school, walks down back to his house, spends one night with his family, and walks back to school Sunday. What they'll do for an education overseas is amazing. Even in China, when I was just there in Tibet, they start school at 8 o'clock in the morning. No one gets out till 9 p.m. at night. They go to school one-third more than our kids do. So obviously, if I don't want to get to talk about educational, but it's going to be a little challenging, I think, down the road for our children. This is a beautiful trail. You can actually see the trail as we kind of go through. This is going up from Tangboche. You just start to see the top of Everest right through there. We're going to come up around this valley, and now you're truly in the Himalayas. And again, the Rinpoche Lama from the monastery has little signs that kind of just, again, kind of the Buddhist point of view is really out there. I have to tell you about my friend Paul Auerbach. Paul Auerbach is the founder of the Wilderness Medical Society. He's a professor of medicine at Stanford. He's a crazy man. But this is Paul on a trek. And this is my good friend Wangshu Sherpa. And they're eating a thing called Dero, which is the most ungodly thing I've ever eaten in my life. But the fact is, it's basically sampa or grains or millet, but kind of done in a taste that didn't really appeal to my palate. And it's really well known for making people kind of not do so well GI-wise. So Paul, of course, he's like, oh, you know, come on, I can, you know, this is like, so he eats this Dero, and, you know, here's Paul about an hour later getting his second liter after he's vomited and diarrhea. Anyway, he's so sick. He is so sick, he actually really told me he feels like this. So we knew we had to get Paul help. Dr. Auerbach definitely needed help, mentally besides physically. But we were going to focus on the physical to begin with. So we took him to Lama Geshe. This is the famous, famous Lama Geshe who lives up in Pangboche. Very old. He's actually essentially been there since Houston, Tillman, and Shipton first got there in the 50s. Remember, 1952 was when we first, 53, entered the Khumbu Valley. So Lama Geshe did a very nice thing for Paul. Anyway, after I kind of cut it off. After he did, he actually gave Paul in one hand a golden Buddha, and kind of whispered something in his ear, and Paul smiled, and then he handed something to his left hand and gave him some Cipro. So Lama Geshe is a very wise man. So anyway, as you get into the Khumbu area, you now basically find this is the Nuptse Lhotse wall. You start to see Everest as you come around. We start going up this beautiful valley that goes around one of my favorite peaks called Ama Diblam. It's basically just a gorgeous, gorgeous peak as you walk by. And this is kind of what trekking looks like. It's just a very wonderful experience where you kind of enjoy folks, enjoy the locals as you trek on up. This is the Himalayan Rescue Association in Fairchay. I spent way too much time. I've spent two seasons in here, so about 8 months of my life at this clinic. When we first arrived, it had no electricity. It had no power. Now it has a wind generator and solar power. It sees everything. This is a Danish lady who actually had a fracture of her ankle. We tried to kind of get her to ride a Tibetan pony or a yak down, but she wanted to hobble down the trail. That's pretty hardcore. Dental issues are a huge problem for us. Thank God my wife's a dental hygienist because that's her. And you'll notice they're in headlamps. This is shot with a flash and there's no light. So we're taking care of a German who's dropped a crown on us. And this is kind of a classic everyday frostbite that you'd see. I don't even think about these anymore. These are really pretty much nothing. And then in days like this, this is a cerebral edema patient who about 2,000 feet higher than us was carried down and had died en route. This has got to be one of the dumbest Danes I've ever met in my life. He brought a 2-year-old up to this area. So this 2-year-old is at 14,500 feet. We don't recommend any pediatric patient going up who's pre-verbal, number one. Because what do kids love to do? They love to touch things and put it in their mouth. Now let me describe the trail up there. The trail is 2,000 years of yak dung. That is the trail. So this kid ended up with horrible gastroenteritis and had to be medically evacuated, as the vast majority of them do that come on up. We'll see all sorts of hand injuries and lower extremity injuries, and this clinic just sees everybody. This is an interesting case. This is a case where you can see I had dark hair and lots of it at that point, so it's 1998. And the fact is, this is a Swede who had gone to 4,000 meters on Ama Diblam and went out to take a pee on the mountain. And while he's climbing with his team, and all of a sudden his team heard all this grunts and groans and all these kind of things, and they kind of actually, he was just very combative. They actually had to duct tape him into his sleeping bag to keep him from falling off the mountain. And they couldn't figure out what the heck was going on. The next day, he cleared. The next morning, by the time he awoke, he cleared. Nobody got the diagnosis yet. So anyway, he goes up to 5,000 meters. He's a young 27-year-old Swede. I feel good this morning. So he goes up to 5,000 meters and goes blind in his right eye. Well, he recognizes there's probably something wrong. So he hikes down. It takes him 3 days to get in my clinic. Literally walks in the door of my clinic while I'm giving a lecture on altitude medicine and collapses. Literally walked in the door and collapsed. Did a thing that I had to scratch my brain on, because he'd have these periods where he'd get hypertensive, bradycardic, and apneic. I'm kind of thinking I've learned this somewhere in medical school. Forgot it, just passed the test. But I think it was the Cushing's response, which meant something bad was going on in the brain. That's about as much I figured out. And right now I'm putting a Foley catheter in him. And he kept having these apneic spells that became so long, I actually found an old ET tube and ultimately had to intubate this guy. So intubated him, and you see all these people hanging around, and these are groups from lectures that I couldn't manage this guy all night alone. I'm going to have to bag him for 16 hours to the next helicopter. I can get a helicopter up there. So I just went to tea houses, got anybody, and said, you know, you got him from noon, or from midnight to 1 a.m. You have him from 1 a.m. to 2 a.m. And this whole group of trekking community came to my help and helped this kid. He ultimately ended up with a subarachnoid, which is classically, by the way, we see those fairly commonly at elevation, and ended up with a subarachnoid, got clipped, and is doing okay. And he's a school teacher and got home Sweden now. But you really do have impact on people's lives on a regular basis. So what's this diagnosis? Yeah, doesn't feel well. That's good. This is high-altitude cerebral edema, and you can almost make the diagnosis without even knowing it. And again, I'm not going to get into pathophysiology of altitude because we don't have the time, but the fact is all brains swell at elevation. And somehow, whether we have the ability to buffer that swelling or not will determine whether or not we partly get maybe acute mountain sickness that goes on to cerebral edema, or again, this whole different animal we call pulmonary edema are the common altitude maladies that one sees at elevation. This is actually kind of Rob Hall's, if you remember 1996, this is Rob Hall's sister, who was actually up in 1998 going to have a Punja ceremony at base camp with John Krakauer, and she got struck by high-altitude cerebral edema and had to be carried down. So, of course, being the good guy I am, I woke John Krakauer up at 4 o'clock in the morning and made him come over and pump the Gamow bag. By the way, the reason I'm using Gamow bag is my oxygen was stolen. So I had no oxygen that year at the clinic. Obviously, Descent, oxygen, Decadron are really treatments of choice. And if you have to, you know, we'll use this as a portable altitude chamber. It goes 2 psi above ambient. So actually, if you're in this bag at 14,500 feet and we're pumping it up with a river pump, basically you're going to be equivalent of about 8,000 feet inside that bag. So your headache and symptoms go away, and I can make you a lot better. Then I can unzip you and kick you down the trail really quick before you crump on me again. So anyway, I got John to come in and pump the bag for that one. This is how the tea houses look nowadays. They're pretty nice. This is the Himalayan Lodge in Fariche. Pretty nice, buffed, and a nice place to go hang out. So let's go from Fariche up to Everest Base Camp. We're going to kind of take this little Fariche sits right here. You can actually see the trail even on Google Earth. Comes up, goes up the lateral moraine of the Khumbu Icefall and comes over here, and then we're going to go up. This is Pomori. Kalapatar, where you shoot the pictures of Everest, are right from here, and then Everest Base Camp. So again, Kalapatar and Everest Base Camp. I'll just show you a different couple of views, but that's where we're kind of heading. So this is kind of the trail from Fariche. We'll take us on up, and we'll kind of walk over here, and we'll come on up the glacier moraine. We kind of walk over here, and you can actually see the little trail that goes to the top of Kalapatar. This is where all the trekkers want to go to shoot the pictures of Everest. This is around 18,000 feet. Everest Base Camp sits out here. This is the beautiful Pomori Peak that sits right behind there. And you walk past the Chortons. This is where all the climbers and people have their memorials for those that have died on Everest. You'll find Scott Fisher's right there. You'll find, again, all the memorials that family members and other people bring on up and put up there. Again, yaks all over the trail. These are the big cattle, so to speak, of the Himalayan region. They're amazingly amazing animals. And again, this is now we've changed our topography. We're kind of on the glacier range. This is a little town called Gorik Shep, just before you go up to Kalapatar and Everest Base Camp sits out there. So, you know, you've kind of changed. I show this picture. This is a classic picture. What's wrong with this picture? It's turned sideways, Cody Quarter, and I did that. I was trying to be cutesy with my camera. You know, I was photographic cutesiness. But the fact is, no one should be riding a pony up the trail. So I sat down with a group of 17 physicians at this point. I was leading a trek up with 17 physicians teaching altitude medicine or wilderness medicine, basically normal junket write-off. Come on, you guys know all that. So the fact is that we're having a normal junket write-off. And the fact is I see this lady go by, and I can guess the diagnosis, and I know she's a victim. Because what happens is she's got a headache. And she felt so bad that her Nepali guide hired her a pony and going to ride her up. So I could bet that night when I see her, she is going to be in dire straits. I've only done this a few years. So the fact is my group didn't pick up on this, and so we walked into a tea house, and my group had a big table, 17 of us sitting around, and she was sitting right next to the table. And she had the classic, you know, hands over the head, and she just looked like she death warmed over. And I walked up to my group and I said, by the way, none of you are going to get a CME certificate. You failed my course. Because less than 10 feet away from you is a lady who will die within the next 6 to 8 hours and you didn't recognize it. And sure enough, she had an O2 sat of 36% and cerebral edema was a major evacuation. You never, ever, ever go up on a pony unless you have a headache and felt bad, which means you shouldn't be going up. This is a classic case of someone who got pulmonary edema and getting assisted walking down. The good news is he can walk. This is kind of classic. They get very chilled. They got their sunglasses on. They're always very cold. So let's go out to Everest ER. So this is what it looks like from Kalapatar. You'll see the Khumbu Icefall, the famous Khumbu Icefall. This is the West Ridge. Of course, this gets to be on the north side. Changsi, by the way, this is the Lola Pass here. Changsi sits in Tibet. So now we're just looking over the pass, and that's Tibet over there. This is the kind of the west rib of Everest, the southwest ridge, which is the classic ridge, and then the south col. So again, I always kind of joke around. Everest gets a lot of press. I mean, for some reason, the people love press. This was in July of 07. Where this article came out, a guy came up and spent a week with us, and they always write these horrible things about us, like, you know, this was a Playboy bunny, by the way, who was summiting, and she had photographic stuff, and it was kind of ridiculous, but, you know, whatever. And the fact is, we were shooting this Everest ER film that you all see. So Luann and I were up there, and they always kind of make bad things. So this was the article, and so they had to put me, like, sipping on my Bombay Sapphire Martini. Now, it wasn't a Bombay Sapphire Martini. If you know me, I drink Bombay Sapphire, but I don't drink a Bombay Sapphire Martini. So the fact is you find these things about Everest all the time, about someone who was left on the summit ridge to die. And there are things like that, and morality at 8,000 meters is a tough game. Let me just make it very simple. I will tell a quick story. I'm going to probably run out of time because I tell too many stories. But the fact is, I was at a two-hospital town one time giving a talk, and one of the trauma surgeons came up and said, you know, I'm really offended that someone would leave someone at the summit ridge to die. And you know, there should have been some way of saving that person. And I said, you know, you have to be at 8,000 meters to understand how difficult it really is. Don't be so judgmental. I mean, there's lots of circumstances. I disagree with it, but I understand it happens, and we can talk about that. Well, interesting enough, I had rented a car, and I was driving to the next hospital to give a talk. And sure enough, right in front of me occurred a motor vehicle accident. And he drove around the motor vehicle accident, and I stopped. Now, one should not throw rocks in a glass house. You know, if we're going to talk about morality at 8,000 meters, don't give me this when you're driving down the highway and you see an MVA and don't stop. It's no, you know, and so the fact is, actually, he was at the next conference and I actually brought this up to his, face, and he didn't really like it that well. But the fact is, Everest is a very, very strange place. So this is our Everest ER. It's just basically a tent. We actually have a lot of toys, bells and whistles. We can do things. We do have a 3-lead EKG, and we have jump kits, and we have a ton of meds, and we have a lot of stuff that we can kind of do all sorts of stuff. And cases like this are daily cases. We carry LP gas up, and of course it gets very cold, and you see these kind of burns on our porters' backs all day long. And again, these kids want to continue carrying. I mean, this is 18,000 feet now. This is ka-ching for them. During this season, this is ka-ching. Sam Splint, I know Sam and Sherry are here. God loves Sam Splints. Use them all over the world. They're the greatest things since sliced bread. But we see a lot of orthopedic issues, and I'm not paid by Sam, but I'd like to be. And the fact is that you just improvise. The art of wilderness medicine is the art of improvisation, how to make stuff up based on knowledge when you have very limited resources. You saw that last night in really Doctors Without Borders at times. You know, you'll see all the way from, you know, abscesses that may need to be drained to, again, teeth problems are a huge problem for us. The Sherpas, for example, which will have dental issues, won't want to come down and go to the dentist. They want us to pull their teeth. Now, I had to get very comfortable pulling teeth. I actually worked with a dentist. Every time I go, I work with a dentist and oral surgeon because I end up doing this all the time. I will tell you, those with veneers are now a total pain in my yin-yang because we've had veneers come off at base camp, and you just can't put them back on. You know, so now we have veneer repair kits at Everest Base Camp. But again, pulling teeth is something that you have to get very comfortable with, and the dental issues. It's the total practice of medicine when you're up at this particular area.
Camp 2, this is Base Camp. Do you copy? Camp 3, this is Base Camp. Do you copy? Doug, do you have your radio on? Over. Base camp to anybody on the mountain, do you copy?
Late on the night of May 22nd, news comes in of 3 climbers missing on the South Col.
Because you got 2 members and 1 sheriff are all possibly in trouble, okay?
Our team will be taking off soon. Apparently it is clearing, and they are going to go and make an attempt.
2 of the climbers are found safe, but a Korean woman has fallen and suffered severe frostbite. Members of other expeditions launch another massive rescue operation. Most do not know her and cannot even communicate with her. The rescuers are already exhausted, fighting for their own lives in the thin air.
Just to get yourself back from Camp 4 is difficult. To carry a dead weight, it's a logistical nightmare, and I can't even imagine trying to get a non-ambulatory person down the Losee Face. That's not only logistically difficult, it's extremely dangerous. So this is going to require a mammoth effort.
It takes 3 brutal days to reach base camp. Remarkably, she's still alive.
These kind of frostbite injuries are very significant up here, and we take them all very seriously. You know, for a 28-year-old, that's what I understand it. I don't know if that's accurate or not, but I understand it's a 28-year-old Korean. This could be very devastating for the rest of her life.
You guys, take your time.
Good job.
How old? 26. All right, you just get to lay back and relax. Can you bend that leg?
Yeah, come on, it's
slow. Larry, you look at that foot for me?
She has pain in the right ankle.
Right foot.
Right foot, she has pain. No wasp, she has no headache, no neck pain, no chest pain.
And no belly pain?
No belly. Is she nauseated, sick to her stomach?
Oh, okay.
Feel vomit, but not.
Okay. We're probably going to stick an IV and some IV fluid.
Yeah.
So we can give her fluid
And at the same time, I can give her medicines so she doesn't pain. We're going to have to splint the extremities so she can't move hands, can't move feet. Very severe frostbite.
Yeah.
Very severe frostbite.
These are limb-threatening, hand-threatening, digit-threatening, feet-threatening injuries, and very significant and very deep. Got an IV in, put her on oxygen, have kept her warm. She's having something to eat and drink right now. She's had some pain medicines. We've actually completely put antibiotic ointment and bandage and splinted all extremities. So essentially in there right now she is immobile. She has splints on both feet and both hands. And now we're probably going to think about how she goes to the bathroom and consider a Foley catheter. And then she truly needs to be evacuated out of here tomorrow morning and get down to Kathmandu to the hospital.
2 days later, an army helicopter flies the Korean climber out of base camp. She's lucky to be alive.
I love the...
So this is kind of like, I just like to show this in the sense that rescues are not easy. This is just her coming down through the icefall. It usually takes, the crew had gone about half by now because we kind of got her through the rough part of the icefall, but it's pretty steep and, you know, it'll take anywhere from 20 to 40 people to really pull people off this mountain. So it's not as simple a thing. If you've ever had to carry someone, I encourage you to throw them in a litter and try to carry someone a football field. It is very challenging, and Everest it presents altitude, cold, and all sorts of other issues. She's a beautiful opera singer that we've got to know in Korea. That's what she does. So thank God she doesn't need. This is her left hand. Now to me, when I saw this, I instantly knew. When you see this, no blebs. This is going to be tissue loss, big time. Blebs are good in my world. This is her right hand, which everyone thought was uglier, which is, means she'll salvage most of this. I guessed she was going to lose she wasn't going to lose anything but the tip of that finger. And so this is kind of us taking care of her, and this is her in Seoul, Korea, and this is kind of the follow-up pictures that you can see what happened to her left hand. She auto-amputated everything on her left hand, and sure enough, on her right hand, it kept everything except for that one tip. So again, we see these actually more common than altitude illness on Everest. Again, this is a pulmonary edema patient. I really don't want to spend a great deal of time on pulmonary edema because it's almost a whole hour in itself just to deal with the kind of the lung issues that people have.
Hey, you know, you can't call us redneck anymore.
Why is that?
It's politically incorrect.
So what are you?
Appalachian American. My daddy was a redneck, and I'm a hillbilly, but now I'm an Appalachian American.
Life at base camp gets back to normal. Between acclimatization climbs, there's not much to do. You make your own entertainment. Drink tea, sunbathe, play golf.
Oh my God.
Crushed it.
Base camp is boring. Right now, we're sitting on the warm, wonderful beach. It's a beautiful day. It's clear, not a cloud in the sky. It's sunny, it's warm. We sit around and wait for a long time, and then all of a sudden, lots of things will happen in a short period of time.
Oh!
Nice bird.
So we do have fun. This is a couple cases I want to show at Everest ER. These are reminders. This is a young gentleman, 27-year-old. I will tell you that I have permission to kind of talk about this case. It's going to trial the first week of October. This is a 27-year-old who moved from the East Coast to the West Coast, wanted to really be a climber, insurance guy, climbed Rainier, climbed Denali, climbed a lot of the major peaks, went to Everest, and he went and saw a physician in Seattle to get his pre-climb physical signed. And he got his pre-climb physical signed, and the guy kind of said, you know, I really think we should really help you out, make sure you can summit. So he put him on 4 milligrams TID of Decadron for 6 weeks, and just told him to stop it when he summited. As well as, by the way, nifedipine daily, Diamox daily, and Cipro daily. So this kid, after 3 weeks, he had gotten up to camp 3. He's right on the final camp before his summit bid. And he comes in and he sits down and he has no idea. The lights are on. There is no one home in this young man. He has no idea why he's there. He cannot tell me his name. He's just completely bleeding was a little bit from his nose, found out he's been rectal bleeding for a while, and found out, so he had huge amounts of Decadron with him, including a whole box of injectable Decadron, all given prophylactically for someone who's never had altitude illness. By the way, this happened on a trekker of mine from Ogden. You have an English professor in mountain in literature who actually just joined me on the north side, who was put by a physician in this community on 10 milligrams of Decadron a day prophylactically on my trek. Fortunately, we got him tapered off and stopped before he got to elevation. So I noticed that this little rash. So I had him take his shirt off. Yeah, those of you that have ever seen kind of Decadron or long-term steroid side effects, he has central adiposity, he had a buffalo hump, and come to find out, the worst thing is 2 days prior to this, we finally got out that he stopped his Decadron. So now I have an acute adrenal insufficiency sitting at Everest Base Camp. And this kid was in serious trouble. We did get him evacuated out. He got septic. We got a crit down to about 12 or 14 in Kathmandu, got multiple transfusions, spent about 3 weeks in Kathmandu, flown to the University of Washington, where he was under the care of neuropsych and endocrinology and everything else. This is now 2 years later, and he has to live in an assisted living home. He still cannot function mentally. I would encourage you to be very cautious in your zeal to prevent and treat acute mountain sickness and altitude problems. If you don't know, ask and check the literature, because this is not what you do. All right? This is a young gentleman. So I actually put him on the helipad. So he's flying down to Kathmandu. Walking back from the helipad, we actually make a helipad on the glacier, and all of a sudden I get yanked to the Irish team tent. And there's two Sherpas back to back laying on a bench in the Irish team, and there's CPR happening to one. I'm like, this is not good. I was hoping they'd invite me over for Irish coffee, but that wasn't the case. And then this young gentleman, I pronounced the first one dead, and couldn't quite. I had two of them. So this kid was respiratory rate was around 70 to 80, big deep Kuzmal type respirations, pulse around 170, 150, 170, blood pressure just palp. I have a real shocky kid on my hand, but I have two of them. Carbon monoxide, you know, what do they eat? What do they do? Well, interesting enough, I'm sitting there trying to put this puzzle together. These are Sherpas. You know, it's not altitude, I'll tell you that. So the fact is that I look in the bottom of the thing, and I find a little bottle of White Stag whiskey. Got the diagnosis? Yeah, it's very common in third world countries and actually common around the world. And this kid, so I brought this kid back. This is him right now. I didn't intubate him because I could not keep up with his ventilations. I was going to wait till he pooped out, but thank God he's a tough, tough Sherpa kid. And put a Foley catheter in, had no urine. Picture is becoming a little bit more clear to me at this point. Call for a helicopter. Can't get a helicopter for 2 days because it just stormed in. So now I have a critically ill kid who has no urine. By the way, on my 3-lead EKG had peaked ST waves. Well, that makes sense, right? So he's probably hyperkalemic, he's not making urine. I have two dead, and I found a bottle of small White Stag whiskey, methanol poisoning. Dr. Johnson. So he's metabolic acidosis. So now what are you going to do? You got him for 2 days. Well, I decided I was not going to let this kid die. I have enough gray hair. I mean, famipazole is the treatment for us in the ER or dialysis. That's easy. But those of us with a few gray hairs recommend booze, acetone, ethanol. So I made a call out to base camp. Russell Bryce gave me a bottle of Smirnoff Hunter Proof vodka. And a 10% IV mixture went straight into his vein. And this is the only surviving kid in all of Nepal who survived a methanol poisoning completely neurologically intact without going blind. This is him. This is actually a doctor from Croatia I recruited, and actually one from Hawaii who's helping me mix up my Smirnoff vodka mixture. we had to imbibe during the treatment. But so the fact is, this is him. This is before we put him on the helicopter. And he was not blind. It's very popular that what they do is they go to hotels. People, the porters or some illegal folks will go to your hotels, pick up the booze bottles, go make bathroom hooch, put it in the bottle, reseal it, and sell it. And methanol poisoning is a huge issue that occurs overseas. This is Nima. He actually tracked me down in a hotel a couple years later, and he's alive and well, no problem. He actually had a little ischemic issue to his foot, but doing okay. And if you just to make this a CME, remember that, you know, methanol goes to formaldehyde. You actually could have used folic acid as well. We certainly used ethanol alcohol is certainly a competitive inhibitor for methanol. And again, this just tells you have to kind of keep that broad-based aspect of medicine. I'm going to kind of end this a little bit so we can get out of here in time. This was last year. This just kind of gives you some idea of what we see. Vast majority of patients that we see at Everest ER, 19 at that time required evacuation. Those are kind of the dental and the medical and all the problems we see. If you look at the kind of the diarrhea, frostbite, and altitude, it's really not that much. Interesting, we see much more upper respiratory. The Khumbu cough, which we could talk about, is really a significant problem up there, and we're studying it right now using salmeterol and fluticasone. So there's some interesting research going on the whole this issue. But you see a broad-based practice. I do have to share with this. What I'd like to do is kind of share a day on Everest, and then I'd like to just close with about 5 minutes of just music and some fun slides, and then we'll get you out of here. This is the 25th. So we get a call that a ladder broke in the crevasses, and a Sherpa carrying a heavy load, again a very heavy load, plunged 30 meters and was injured pretty bad. Also, someone else had fallen at the same time. It was a female European climber. She was 30 meters down, 90 feet, bleeding from her head, vomiting blood, and couldn't use her legs. This day was going to crap in a hurry. This is what it likes, by the way, if you're ever crossing ladders. This is what we do. Last year there was 49 ladders we had to cross to get through the Khumbu Icefall to get up to the main mountain. So it gets a little hairy when you're crossing cheap Kmart ladders, by the way. But so soon after, we actually sent some rescue teams up, and we were heading up, and all of a sudden we had a guy who had probably a huge mucus plug, which are big problems at times when you get so dry. Actually, Caldwell Extreme Expedition, which was measuring some Everest weather things, actually measured the relative humidity as zero. Actually had to recalibrate their instruments, and it still measured zero. So it's a very, very dry place, and every time he moved his head, this guy shut his airway off. That was a problem. And then we had a European climber show up with a very, very bad frostbitten hand. At the same time, we got called that there was a climbing guide who looked like he was having kind of either a cerebral edema or a stroke, and there was just a recent one that we had that truly had a stroke on Choyoyu and had to be... So we had that going on. And then just when we thought anything couldn't have, all of a sudden there was another climber who probably had cerebral edema high up in the mountain that we had to deal with. So this is kind of an average day sometimes on Everest ER. Yes, you can play the Everest Open Golf Tournament, but at sometimes it gets a little exciting. So our Sherpa, fortunately, just had fractured ribs and lots of bruises. The woman climber, she had an avulsion fracture of her left knee, two bad back fractures, bruises, and she had to get flown out of Camp 1. Now, Camp 1 sits around 19,000 feet, and the last time anyone was evacuated from there was 1978 when the Italians had a helicopter up there and crashed it. This is the new B-3 Eurocopter. This is the new mountain helicopter that's used at Aconcagua, Denali, and now Everest. That actually can go up, actually landed on the summit, by the way, if you've got time. I have a great video of this landing on the summit, which people thought couldn't happen. But the fact is this is a B-3 rescuing her from Camp 1. This has not occurred since 1978. So we actually were able to get a helicopter to Camp 1 because we could not get her through the icefall. The MRI, the guy with the guide with that severe dizziness actually had some kind of labyrinthitis, which I kind of have a question about. At least that was diagnosed down in Kathmandu. The guy who went crazy high in the mountain was really thought to have cerebral edema, and everything else was negative and clean. I will tell you, it comes without its own risks. I have some pictures I can't show you because in 2009, on May 25th, normally what happens is to climb Everest, what ends the Everest season is monsoon. And monsoon is low pressure systems that come up from the Bay of Bengal. And what it does is it kicks a high pressure system off and kicks the winds off Everest, so to speak. So you get a period of beautiful weather on Everest in the springtime, which allows people to climb it. But usually when that low pressure system comes in, the climbing season ends, because that really starts monsoon season. And usually monsoon will come up, and the big low pressure system will come up through Bangladesh and go over to Myanmar and Laos and Cambodia. Well, in 2009, it actually turned into a cyclone. So we had a full-blown hurricane, and unbeknownst to all the weather forecasters, came straight up and hit Everest. Fortunately, most of us had left base camp except myself. I had three patients, one with a kidney stone, pulmonary edema, and a respiratory problem. And overnight, we had about 6 to 8 feet of snow. And I actually was buried alive at that point. And I would encourage you not to do that in your future. I woke up, I remember being very happy, really happy. And then all of a sudden my Sherpa, who woke up about 4:30 in the morning, he actually half his tent collapsed. So he woke up, stepped out of his tent, and the snow was above his clavicles. So he actually put his Gore-Tex on. He couldn't see a tent out there. We were all buried. And he actually swam over to my tent, and I remember hearing, they call me Papa Eric because I'm such an old fart. And I keep hearing, Papa Eric, are you alive? And about the 10th time I got angry, going like, I'm so happy. And I remember waking up, and I tried to get up, and I had the snow about an inch off my nose, and I couldn't move. I mean, I literally was cocooned, which I never had claustrophobia. I can now really not sit next to a window seat in a tight airplane. It's a little bit weird. But the fact is that it was a pretty amazing experience, and Lhakpa essentially saved my life by digging me out. Matter of fact, I figured out how was he going to dig me out? I figured I was already kind of getting quite hypoxic and rebreathing my CO2. And interesting enough, he found a plate on top of the snow, why a plate was there after, you know. By the way, the forecast was for 2 more meters of snow. So on the 25th, we evacuated base camp and left a climbing team up. The Kyrgyzstan team was up on Everest and got completely buried. Last time we got a phone call or a radio contact, there were 12 feet of snow. So it can be bad. Then you come down from this beautiful experience, and I got to show you, this is Lukla. And let's take off from Lukla. Taking off from Lukla is always a really treat, especially when the plane starts going up. I'm really happy with up. What I'd like to do, if you got a few more minutes, is just 5 minutes, is I always like to end up with, because we've talked a lot, but I like to end up with just some pictures and a little music about pretty pointed peaks. Himalayas are a lot of times about pretty pointed peaks, so if you have 5 minutes, I'd like to share a little bit of music and some slides with you. And then we can get you off to your next meeting here. I'd like to thank my my wonderful wife, who after 32 years keeps letting me go out of these crazy places, and I drag her around. And thank you all. By the way, anyone who wants to join, I'm going to take a group back through the Wilderness Medical Society next year. $3,200 with CME, all the way from Kathmandu to Everest Base Camp and back. You'll never find a price like that. I have a few contacts with the government. $2,900 if you don't need CME. And thank you, and I'm around for questions because I think you guys got to go. So I appreciate your time. Thank you.